Hey everyone, welcome to my video series on writing applications for the Flipper Zero. It's difficult to know where to begin when writing an app because there's a lot of steps involved. If you instead start with a skeleton app and modify the code to do what you need, it's typically much easier. This is iterative development, allowing you to test as you make changes. At some point, you've modified so much of the project, it becomes your own app. In this video, we're going to start by learning about the skeleton app I wrote, which gives a starting point for writing many Flipper Zero applications. In future videos, we'll add body to our skeleton and morph it into another application. Let's get started. I wrote the skeleton app, hoping it would solve a few problems. The first problem I already talked about, which is it's hard to start from a blank project and it takes time. The next problem is often people create interesting apps, but we don't have any instructions or even a link to those instructions. Sometimes even the purpose of the app is unclear. We don't see any of the warnings that's in the readme, and we also don't know what additional hardware is required to run the app. We typically also don't know where to go for support or to give our thanks. Finally, configuration is often hard-coded, or it isn't obvious how to wire up the hardware. Let's look at how an application can benefit from starting with the skeleton app. First, we have the flashlight application. We can press OK to turn it on, and the light is on, and we can press OK to turn it off, and the light's off, but we don't really know how to connect the light, what kind of light, or anything. We also don't know who wrote the app, or where to find the readme, which actually does a really good job of explaining what pins connect to what. Here I rewrote the flashlight app, starting with the skeleton app, and you can see now we have directions that explain how to connect it, where to order the parts, that kind of stuff. And then in configure, we're able to change which pin the LED needs to connect to, and we can see what the default pin is if we want to connect that LED. We can also choose whether or not we want to turn off the light when we exit the app or leave it in whatever state it was on before. And then down in about, we can see information about where to find that flashlight app and any other information we want to give the user. And finally, the light just works like it before. We click the button and we flip the light from on and off, but now we know how to configure it and where to go for support. Let's look briefly at the skeleton app running on the Flipper Zero, and then afterwards we can look at the code. The goal of the skeleton app is to provide an outline, but we should feel free to change anything, customize it for our needs, like making it into that flashlight app. You can see our app is called WIP Skeleton Sample App, and it has an icon that needs to be edited. So for sure, you're going to want to change both of those things. When we start the application, we see a menu. This menu is called the submenu because the main menu was that Flipper menu where we picked apps at the very beginning. I sometimes refer to this as just the menu or the app menu. Next, we'll go into the config screen. And this is a variable item list with two items for our settings. The first item, team color, has three choices, which is red, green, or blue. We use the left and right arrow keys to select the items, and clicking OK doesn't do anything. The second item is name, which defaults to Bob. And when we click OK, we see this enter name and the current value. We're able to edit that value. I'll go ahead and say bot instead. And then we can click on save. Also, when we go into bot, if we click the back button, we return back to our config menu. Go ahead and do back to get out of this menu, and we'll go down to about. And here you can see more information about the application. If we go to play, this is our main application. We can see the random values keep changing. We can see the team is red and the value associated is one. And we can see the name is bot that we typed in. Using the right and left arrow keys, we can see the X changes and the drawing moves as well. When we press the OK button, we can hear a brief tone based on the current X value. And the up and down keys don't currently do anything, but we could change the code so that they do. Now let's dig into the project. Our application.fam file has that app ID we're going to want to change to be our unique app. And then the name we're going to want to change to be the name of our application. And then the entry point, we'll want to name the method that we want to call to start our program. And then the category, like GPIO or sub-gigahertz, depending on what your app is. And then the FAP description so that people know what your application is used for. Next, we have the app.png, which is the icon for your app. You definitely want to change that. And then in the assets folder, we have the different PNGs that your application wants to render. Typically a black and white PNG and the dimensions in the file name. And then you're going to want to modify the README to have all those directions. But again, remember, people may not know where your README is. So in your application, you're going to want to give them a URL where they can go read that README. Now let's look at the main application code in app.c. We start off with a bunch of include statements for all the functions we want to be able to call. You can add additional includes here. Next, we define a tag if we have any logging. And then we define if the backlight should stay on while the app's running or if it should automatically turn off after no interaction. We define the IDs for our submenu for configure, game, and about. If you want to add more entries, you'd add those items here. And then we define all the different views, like the submenu, the input dialog we saw, that configure screen, our main game screen, and the about page. If you added a menu item, you'd also add a view here for that new page to show. And our custom event IDs is for redrawing the screen, and we have an ID for when the OK button's pressed. Next, we have the structure that has our view dispatcher, notifications, all of our UI elements like submenu, text input, view widgets. And then we have something special for that variable item for that second setting because we can click on it. We want to be able to type in the text and recall the text. And then we have a timer object for redrawing the screen periodically to show that random number. And our game has a model with three properties. The first one is the setting one index. The next one is the setting two's name, and the last one is that X value. For simplicity, the skeleton app doesn't use a scene manager, so we have methods that return all of the views that the back button can navigate to. Our submenu callback tells the view dispatcher to switch to the view based on the index that was clicked on. Next, we have our setting one's configuration. So we have that label of team color. And then we have the values of 1, 2, 4 that's associated with each team and the labels, which are red, green, and blue. You could change this to be frequencies or pins or whatever you need for your application. And then we have setting two, which has that label of name, the enter text, and our default value. And when the value is updated, we update our model and we say false for the redraw since they're still in the configuration screen. And then after that, we have our setting item clicked. And it's a zero-based index, so we just do the plus plus to make it one-based. And then we check if the second item was clicked, then we go ahead and populate a buffer. And then we start configuring that text input dialog, set the back button so it loads our config screen, and then tell the view dispatcher to switch to the text input view. Next comes the code that draws our main screen. And typically in this code, you're going to want to just use values from your model. In this particular example, I'm also using random just so you can see every time the draw callback gets invoked. And next we have the game timer callback. And every time it gets invoked, we go ahead and tell the view dispatcher to redraw the screen. Our skeleton view game enter callback gets invoked when you click play, and it just sets up a timer every 200 milliseconds to call that timer callback. And then the game exit callback gets invoked when you click that back button, and it goes ahead and just stops and frees the timer. So enter and exit is where you would do your initialization and your freeing of resources. Next, we have our game custom event callback, and it handles the redraw screen by telling our view model to do a redraw true. And if the OK button is pressed, it plays a tone based on the X value. Otherwise, we return false because we didn't handle the message. Next up is our main application's input callback. And when you do a short press and release of the left button, we go ahead and decrement the model's X value. And likewise, for the key right, we increment the X value in the model. And then for the OK button, they want to hear the tone when they press it, not after they've released it. And so we go ahead and tell the view dispatcher the OK button is pressed, and that's where that does that processing and makes the tone. You could have put the tone code in here instead of setting a custom event. It's just a matter of preference. Next, we have our skeleton app alloc that allocates that main object. You can see it has config, play, and about. You could reorder those and relabel those and add additional items here. And then we also have our stuff for our setting one, including the default index for setting one. You could duplicate this code to make additional settings. And then we had that setting two, which was the clickable setting, where we did text input, or you could do byte input or any of that kind of input-y type stuff. And next we set up our view game with all of its callbacks. And that's what has our model. So we set the model properties like our setting one index, our setting two name, and our X value. On line 438, you can see we have our help text. So definitely want to replace that with help text for your application. And then we have our skeleton app free code, and that's going to make sure it removes all the views from the view dispatcher and frees all those objects that we allocated. And then finally, we have our entry point, which was main skeleton app. And you'll want to double check that in your application.fam file, the entry point has the same function name, main skeleton app, or whatever you've named your main application. Thanks for taking the time to learn about the skeleton app. Hopefully you can see how it can give you a head start on your app development for Flipper Zero and make your applications easier for people to use. In a future video, we'll be modifying the program to accomplish a totally different task. Please like, subscribe, and click that notification bell. Also, don't forget to join me in Discord for more conversations and giveaways.